preferring the comfort of his nearness, we have not heard enough about his transcendence. And we have tended to lower God and make him in our image. Kind of like the picture of that little chorus we've been singing. He can do it. Yes, he can. He will prove it. Our God can. It's just such an awesome thought to think of the Lord as Isaiah saw him revealed, sitting on a throne, and then see there a high and lifted up. Not just any throne. Some translations say a lofty and exalted. Now, the main reason that the church has lost its moral vision is that it has lost its high and exalted view of God. Listen, embracing the comfort of his nearness, we have lost the compelling force of his transcendence. I say it again, embracing the comfort of his nearness. Oh, Pastor, give us another series on God's love. Give me another series on his compassion. And all of these things are wonderful truths. But preferring the comfort of his nearness, we have not heard enough about his transcendence. And we have tended to lower God and make him in our image and humanize God, as it were. God is not an old codger with a white beard. He's not the man upstairs. He's not Big Daddy. He is ineffable glory, and he dwells in unapproachable light. And no one can see God and live. And our God is a consuming fire. Now, these are the things that the Bible says about God, and this is what Isaiah saw, and it altered him, and maybe we would be less casual about our behavior choices if we remembered who this God that we love and serve really is. George Barna did a study on the behaviors of evangelicals. Interesting, the statistics are remarkably similar between believers and non-believers. 19% of believers watch MTV, the music channel, in the past week. 24% of non-believers. 27% of evangelicals have been divorced, very similar for non-believers. 23% of believers bought a lottery ticket in the past week. 27% of non-believers. More non-believers give money to homeless people. Exact same number, 70% subscribe to what we might consider questionable television channels. 3%, 4% respectively filed a lawsuit in the past year. 76% of evangelicals watched a movie R-rated or higher in the past 3 months, 87% of non-believers. It's really interesting. Barna goes on and says, interestingly, the stumbling block for the church is not its theology. That's not what the world is stumbling over, not what we believe. Their stumbling block is over our failure to apply what we say we believe in compelling ways. Those who have turned to Christianity and churches seeking the truth and meaning have left empty-handed and confused by the apparent inability of Christians themselves to implement the principles that they profess. A man I appreciate greatly, David Wells, has written a book called Losing Our Virtue: Why the Church Must Recover Its Moral Vision. And in it, David Wells says this, listen, evangelical churches have grown in numbers and size. Ministries have been developed that did not exist. Scholars abound. Libraries have been expanded. Seminaries are numerous. Politicians take note. But along with this astounding growth, there has nevertheless come a hollowing out of evangelical conviction, an erosion of character to the point that today no discernible ethical differences are evident in the behavior when those claiming to be born again are compared with their secular neighbors. And then this, I just think this is really interesting, that as these churches have grown, as these things have happened, Wells harkens back to 25 years ago to the start of his ministry when he was a seminary professor. He says, at a time when you could still use the word theology in a church without having to reach for the smelling salts, as in everybody would immediately faint because what was being talked about was not readily usable to me right now. We don't want to build a robust theology. We want a drive-through sermon with a quick inspiration. And we wonder why our faith fails us in the hardest of times. Well, let's go back now for the remainder of this study to Isaiah 6. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up, and the train of his robe filled the temple. I love that part. The train of his robe. The train of a robe. Ladies, anybody have a kind of a train on your a wedding dress when you got married? Hands up if you had that. Nicely done. Was there a little bit kind of dragging out there behind you? Do you know why? I noticed that you don't have one of those on at church tonight. Well, why'd you wear one on your wedding day? Well, the reason you did is because the train of a robe, it's a symbol of honor. And the longer the train of the robe, the greater the honor. And you wouldn't show up at church with that on, but when you wore that in your wedding, everyone think, of course she's wearing it, it's her day, right? It was a symbol of you being honored. Can anybody call to mind the picture of the coronation of Queen Elizabeth? She's been queen now for a very long time. But when she was coronated, I see them there carrying the train of her robe. I mean, it went down the aisle and almost out the back door of Westminster Abbey. That's how long her train was. I mean, it takes how many people are carrying it in that picture? I mean, who does she think she is, the queen of... Oh, yeah, right. She is the queen of England. And get this, the train of her robe is the symbol of her splendor. The longer the train, the greater the honor. Now look again at what Isaiah saw. Notice at the end of verse 1, on a throne, high and lifted up, and the train of his robe, what's it say? It filled the temple. Down the aisle, and back and forth, and back and forth, doubling and redoubling until the symbol of God's splendor filled the temple where he was. Too much? Too much? Undeserving? I think not. I think a perfect description of ultimate, infinite honor. He is holy, holy, holy. The repetition is communicating the immenseness and the all-encompassing nature of this unifying and central characteristic of God.
Yeah. The other day, my buddy and I were out playing with a drone that he uses to capture footage for various ministry needs around the church. Well, anyway, we were out on the balcony, and I gotta say what shocked me was I looked down front and I saw the fountain in our church working. And we haven't used that thing for, I bet you, 10 years. It's been since I saw it actually bursting forth with water, but there it was. And it reminded me of the story that Jesus told about how he wanted to be like that fountain in our lives. Maybe things have become parched and dry for you. Maybe it's a long time since you felt the joy of Jesus Christ welling up inside you. And, you know, I've spent a lot of time searching the scriptures, finding what causes the fountain to burst forth with fresh water again. I think I found it, and I want to help you experience this afresh for yourself.
Contact us right now, and by supporting this ministry with any amount, we will send you Fresh Start, a new 31-day devotional designed to help you enter into God's presence on a daily basis and experience Him in a powerful new way. You'll also receive a set of 16 video devotionals from James MacDonald. See what Pastor James's personal quiet time looks like and join in as he shares several devotions from God's Word. Request Fresh Start when you call or go online today. And by supporting this ministry with $75 or more, we'll also send you our brand new coffee mug set, as well as Pastor James's 5-message Times of Refreshing audio series. Perfect for you and your spouse or a friend, our mugs contain a reminder to stay in the scriptures, enjoy some morning coffee alongside your daily devotionals, or while you listen to Pastor James visit some of his favorite passages in scripture that talk about spending time in the presence of the Lord. Request this new collection today when you call 800-545-6800 or go online to jamesmacdonald.tv.
So he sees the Lord, and it's like, I saw him, and he's on his throne, and the train of his robe, and high, and lifted up, and then he's like, let me tell you about the angels. These kids didn't have anything else he can think of to say. And so now he goes to describing around the throne, verse 2, above him, that's the Lord, above him stood the seraphim. I love that. Seraphim, angels. And what are they doing? They're standing, ever standing to serve the seated sovereign. The Hebrew here for seraphim is literally burning ones. Seraph is the word. Countless burning throngs. And now he describes them. Above him stood the seraphim. Each had, how many?
Six.
Each had 6 wings. This is getting awesome. Each had 6 wings. Now just think, there, God is on the throne right now. Right, turn to your neighbor and say, right now. And these burning seraph are there in his presence. Tell him again. Right now. They're there right now. And get this. They have these 6 wings. Man, what do they need 6 wings for? What are they doing with their 6 wings? Notice, with 2, he, describing an individual seraph now, with 2 he covered his face. Why? Lest he gaze on infinite holiness and be consumed in a moment, incinerated. So with 2 he covers his face. With 2 he covers his feet. Yeah. Lest God see me. I don't want to see him. I don't want him to see me. That sense of unutterable holiness. And with 2 he flew. Just keeping himself there in that standing position with 2 wings. It's interesting. 4 wings for relating to God. I don't want to see him, and I don't want him to see me. 4 wings for relating to God. 2 wings for serving God. I think there's something in that. and how often we spend so much of our energy serving God and so little of our energy just being in worshipful relationship with God. Well, anyway, all three of these verbs, covered, covered, and flew, are continuous action. Their motion is ceaseless as they fulfill the bidding of Almighty God. Verse 3, here it goes. And one called out to another and said, picture two lines. I'm picturing two lines of these seraph going out as far as the eye can see from the throne in the presence of God, standing, hovering in place, as it were, and calling out back and forth. And one called out to another. That's an antiphonal chorus. I'm always after the worship team to sing antiphonally. That's where part of the congregation sings part of the song and the other part of the congregation sings the other part of the song. It's so alive and dynamic when that's happening, and that's what's happening here. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. Now, let's start just with the word holy. It's a kind of a churchy word in a way, and it just means a separate, a set apart. When the Bible says that God is holy, it's telling us that he's not like us. You say, well, in what way? In every way. He's not like us. You say, well, I thought we're made in his image. Well, we may have some parallels to him, but he doesn't have many parallels to us. All right? He is unparalleled. He is unprecedented. He is all that we could ever imagine him to be and so much more. And so God is completely separate. There is no being like him. Jot down Exodus 15, 11. Who is like you, O God? Majestic in holiness, awesome in praises, working wonders. Then notice this. Notice the repetition. Holy, holy, holy. The three-peat is making a point that would be hard for us. An idiom of the Hebrew language is that emphasis is showing a size and space and a personhood. It's showing dimension. So, for example, if you said, I was out for a walk, and this is in Hebrew, if you said, I was out for a walk and I fell in a hole, yeah, well, I bet you got out pretty easy, you know. But if they would say, I was out for a walk and I fell in a hole. You go, oh, that's rough. Are you okay? You know, did you get out? But if you said, I was out for a walk and I fell in a hole, that's how they would talk. And if they said it three times, that's just like mega to the max. You can't. Now, interesting. Only here and only of this characteristic do we learn God is not holy. God is not holy, holy. He is holy, holy, holy. The repetition is communicating the immenseness and the all-encompassing nature of this unifying and central characteristic of God. Kadesh is the Hebrew. Kadesh, Kadesh. It's the, this three thing is the strongest superlative form in the Hebrew language. So back to the text, this is what they're calling out in heaven. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. And then this, the whole earth is full of his glory. And I've taught many times that God's holiness is You know, the central defining characteristic of his nature, and that God's glory is what emanates from God's presence. We don't see God, we see his glory, we see evidence. Glory is evidence that God exists. In a vertical church like ours, it's all about the revealing of the glory of God, the manifest presence of God, the evidence of God's existence and his work in our midst. And so when it says here, the whole earth is full of his glory, there's no place on the earth where his glory is not seen. The heavens are declaring the glory of God, and the earth is showing his handiwork, the psalmist said. And everywhere we see it, we see his glory. Now, I'm not going to try to make you say this antiphonally, but this is the song that's going on in heaven right now. And so let's just say that first phrase, holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. Imagine it's being said right now. Let's join the chorus. Lift up your voice and say it. Come on.
Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts.
And the next line, the
whole earth is full of his glory.
As Isaiah saw the scene, the Lord, the throne, his robe, the burning angels, and he heard the heavenly chorus. No wonder it says here, and the foundations of the threshold shook at the voice of him who called, and the house was filled with smoke. The foundations of the threshold trembling, and no doubt the whole temple was shaking, but Isaiah now no doubt prostrate at the doorway as holiness says, this far, no further, and he falls on his face, and the hymn is thunderous, shaking the temple, filling it with smoke, and the foundation of the thresholds shook. And now the voice of him who called out, and the house was filled with smoke, to quickly veil Isaiah's vision. And there's the grace of God right there. And the smoke comes up, and he can't see anything anymore. Veiling Isaiah's vision, lest he be consumed in another moment by the unspeakable, unsearchable, infinite holiness of the Triune God, the moral worthiness, the utter terror and majestic holiness of Almighty God. Now, that, loved ones, is a view of God that we have lost in the church. We have lost our view of the highness and the holiness of God.
Sometimes at the end of these messages, you drop these huge statements, and I wonder if the people watching, I mean, feel the gravity of that, what it means to have lost the holiness of God.
Well, you know, it was Tozer, my favorite preacher, A.W. Tozer, who said that what you think about God is the most important thing about you.
Yeah.
And I don't know what you think about God, but I'll say, you know, the very same thing to you. What you think about God is the most important thing about you. And if you have some narrow, little, helpful, prayer answering only God, but you don't have a high and majestic view of the awesomeness and the terror and the wonder and the grandeur and the transcendence of a holy God, then, you know, he's helpful, like, you know, a trip to Aldi's and on the store, he's going to pick up a few things, and but he's not worth giving your life for, and you're not confident in his goodness in the middle of the night. So, you know, bigger view of God, what I always say, big God, small problems. Small God, big problems. Yeah. So a lot is lost when we get a small view of God.
Has there ever been a time in your life where you feel like, I in this moment or in this situation, I lost that view of holiness of God?
Yeah, absolutely. I think that different times when I've had anxiousness, when I went through my cancer, you know, briefly, when we were dealing with various things in our family, difficult things in the church sometimes, I think that life tends to shrink your view of God and elevate the size of your problems. And one of the things that we hope happens every time on Walk in the Word is that gets reversed. When you turn on the television to get smaller me, bigger God, every time from the Word.
Exactly. And we want to show you about something else that will help you do that. So watch this.
Contact us right now. And by supporting this ministry with any amount, we will send you Fresh Start, a new 31-day devotional designed to help you enter into God's presence on a daily basis and experience Him in a powerful new way. You'll also receive a set of 16 video devotionals from James MacDonald. See what Pastor James's personal quiet time looks like and join in as he shares several devotions from God's Word. Request Fresh Start when you call or go online today. And by supporting this ministry with $75 or more, we'll also send you our brand new coffee mug set, as well as Pastor James's 5-message Times of Refreshing audio series. Perfect for you and your spouse or a friend, our mugs contain a reminder to stay in the Scriptures, enjoy some morning coffee alongside your daily devotionals, or while you listen to Pastor James visit some of his favorite passages in Scripture that talk about spending time in the presence of the Lord. Request this new collection today when you call 800-545-6800 or go online to jamesmacdonald.tv.
I love how Pastor James's messages are so filled with God's Word and have taught me how to study God's Word for myself.
I've enjoyed every minute of Pastor James's services. I love coming here. It has blessed my life. It has made me a better person, a stronger individual, and I feel much, much closer to the Lord.
What now, Dad?
Well, I would say that we're not quite finished our message on Isaiah 6.
Yeah.
So I would say, hey, keep your Bible open. Keep your Bible open as much as you can when you're listening to Walk in the Word. Have your Bible there. Have it open. I'm not an entertainer. I'm not just trying to make you laugh, though I hope we do that sometimes, because laughter is like medicine, right? But do this. Stay in Isaiah 6. Don't miss the next program. Read it over a few times yourself. Our goal here is not that you would find a preacher you have to hear all the time, but that in hearing this preacher, you would be reminded that the life-giving message is in the Bible itself, and you would renew your commitment to stay in the Scriptures.
This program was paid for by the friends and partners of Walk in the Word.